جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله الذي يجيبني حين أناديه ويستر علي كل عورة وأنا أقصيه ويعظم النعمة علي فلا أجازيه. نحمده ونسبحه ونقدسه على آلائه ونعمائه ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له إلها واحدا أحدا فردا صمدا قيوما نؤمن له بالربوبية ونقر له بالعبودية. من يهدي الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. ونشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وترحم على محمد وآل محمد كأفضل ما صليت وسلمت وباركت وترحمت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. وصل اللهم وسلم على جميع الأنبياء والمرسلين والأوصياء والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وعترة نبيك الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين والصفوة الخيرة من أصحابه المنتجبين ومن تبعهم بإحسان وإيمان إلى يوم الدين. عباد الله، أوصيكم وأوصي نفسي بتقوى الله ولزوم أمره. قال ربنا العزيز في الكتاب الكريم، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: إن الله لا يظلم الناس شيئا ولكن الناس أنفسهم يظلمون. صدق الله العلي العظيم.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى
محمد. There is an important philosophical theme in the Islamic theology that requires some attention, although we discussed this numerous times in the past 18 years, but it's not bad to again come back to this subject once in a while, because people ask about it and people would like more clarification on this subject. And that subject is الجبر والتفويض. The concept of coercion, God forcing people to do things, and people having no will and no say and no choice, versus the school that says people have full choice and full freedom, and God does not interfere in their life whatsoever. When he creates them, he just leaves them by themselves. He does not interfere in their life. These two schools, both of them are extreme. There is a third school that adopted by Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, which is called the school of Amrun Bayna Amrain. It's a matter between the two, which we will come to it inshallah. But this subject, I divide this subject into several parts. We cannot comprehend the whole subject in one session, so it might be four or five sessions on this subject. And this question, whether man is forced to do things or to be someone, to be either good or bad, versus the school that says God has no role in his life whatsoever, has been the subject of debate for many centuries. And this debate preceded the time of Islam. Even before Islam, philosophers were engaged. If you go to philosophers who came before Islam, they also were engaged in this debate and this discussion that we are forced or we have a freedom. But then the predominant thought in the Arabian Peninsula before Islam among the pagans, Abadatul Asnam, the pagans, was that man had no choice in this life. He's forced. whatever you are here, you are now, they believe whatever you are is has been imposed on you by God, and you had no role, no say in it whatsoever. Till the rest of your life, till the end of your life, you have no role in what you do, or what you say, or what you believe in. And this is what the Quran tells us. Quran in Surah Al-An'am says, سَيَقُولُ الَّذِينَ أَشْرَكُوا. They would tell you, Ya Rasulallah, don't be surprised. Those, can you turn this off, please? Those who have disbelieved, أَشْرَكُوا, they will tell you, لَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَا أَشْرَكْنَا. If God had willed, we wouldn't have disbelieved in Him. But because He wanted me to be a disbeliever, He wanted me to worship the idols. This is the will of God. This is not my choice. So they believed in jabr, coercion, that God imposed paganism on me. It is not my own free will. In another verse in Surah Al-A'raf 28, وَإِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً, the non-believers, if they commit a shameful act, they say, قَالُوا وَجَدْنَا عَلَيْهَا آبَاءَنَا. First of all, we saw our forefathers doing the same thing. So this is our tradition, our customs. Second, وَاللَّهُ أَمَرَنَا بِهَا. And God commanded us to practice this fahisha, this shameful act. He forced that upon me. I had no choice but to practice this fahisha, this shameful act. So the Quran says, قُلْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَأْمُرُ بِالْفَحْشَى. Indeed, the Lord, He would not command anyone, any human, to practice shameful acts. But then, even when Islam came and when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came, and he forcefully negated the idea of jabr, and he introduced the idea of a free will, but a limited free will, not an absolute free will, as we are going to explain in the future, inshallah. It's not an absolute free will, 100% freedom you can do with yourself or determine your future. It's not 100% free will. It is limited. It's a partnership between the abd and the Lord, the servant and his Lord. So the Prophet came and he introduced the idea of free will, that Allah has endowed on us reason, aql, and with reason comes the choice. Otherwise, if you have no choice, why should you have aql? There is no need to use your aql, your brain, if you have no choice. If we are like animals, they don't need the aql, reason, because they are animals and they have no choice. They are guided by others, musayyir, guided. Others, they control them. While man is not controlled by others, he's not supposed to be controlled by others, and he's supposed to use his reason, his aql, to choose his path. Now, most of us today, we are Muslims because we incorporated aql, hopefully, inshallah. Most of us are the followers of the school of Ahlul Bayt because this is a matter of choice. We compared this school with others and we found that this is a school is the most authentic, the most accurate, the closest one to the path of the Quran and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we discovered that through aql, through reason, through understanding, the power of intellect. The power of intellect tells you that this is a wrong path and that is the right path. Because you had choice. Allah did not impose on you. As we're going to read in some Sunni traditions, Sahih Muslim and others, they say that God, when man is nutfa, a drop of semen in his mother's womb, God will say that either he will be good or bad. Either he's going to be good or bad. So he, when God says, God ordains on him and imposes on him that, let's say you are good. Even if he does evil for 7 years, the last minute before his death, he's going to do good and he's going to go to paradise. Because God ordained on him. Since he was small a drop, God said, this small drop has to be good. And it has to go to paradise, no matter what it does in this life. So even if he does evil, even if he disbelieves in God, he's mushrik, kafir, but last minute before his death, God is going to switch him from shirk into iman, because God wants him to go to paradise. Not because the guy, he wants to go to paradise. No, it's not his free will. It's not his choice. God wants him to push him, to kick him inside paradise. And they say, on the other hand, in Sahih Muslim, and since the camera is recording, I have to tell you the reference, because people want to see the reference. The reference is in Sahih Muslim. It's for next week. I left it for next week. The hadith, I left it for next week. It is in Sahih Muslim. I'm going to give you other references. He says, on the other hand, there are others that once he's nutfah. Nutfah means he's a small sperm in his mother's womb. Allah decides that this nutfah has to be cursed and he has to be evil and he must go to hellfire. So even if this poor nutfa is going to be born and he will do good things for 7 years, he's worshipping God, but last minute God will switch him from iman into shirk so he can take him to hellfire. So that person has no choice over his deeds or behavior. God is controlling him. God is imposing on him. This is unacceptable. In the school of Ahlul Bayt, we don't accept such a hadith. Because it does contradict the Quran. And I would tell you where it does contradict the Quran. So even though the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam came, to change this concept of coercion that runs in the mind of people that God forces us. We mentioned two verses that mushrikeen, they said to the Prophet, God wants me to be a mushrik, he cannot change me. If God imposes his will on me, nobody can change me. They introduce this argument. Allah says, no, we don't impose shameful acts or evil on people. This is their personal choice. But this residue remained. This type of thinking, they believe in jabr, in coercion, even after the death of the Prophet, it remained among some Muslims. Among those Muslims were the caliphs, Abu Bakr and Umar. When we examine their sayings, for instance, Khalifa al-Thani Umar al-Waqidi narrates in his book, Maghazi al-Waqidi. Waqidi is a Sunni historian, chapter 3. Page 904, he says, Umm al-Harith al-Ansariya, one of the companions of the Prophet, she asked Umar ibn al-Khattab, when they were defeated in the Battle of Hunayn. Remember, the Battle of Hunayn took place during the last days of the life of the Prophet. After the conquest of Mecca, after Fath Mecca, Muslims were very powerful, they recaptured Mecca. Mecca now is under Islamic control. Immediately after that, there was another battle between the Muslims and the Mushrikeen near the city of Ta'if, which is currently near Mecca. The Battle of Hunayn. Muslims were defeated in the beginning. They ran away. Only 5 people stayed with the Prophet. As-Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, inshallah, they ran away. When it comes to running away, they were the fastest, believe me, in running. Within a few minutes, they climb the tall mountain. Within a few seconds, you see them at the top of the mountain. This is not me, huh? This is the Quran. سورة آل عمران: إذ تصعدون ولا تلوون على أحد والرسول يدعوكم في أخراكم. You run away and you don't even bother to look behind you to see what happened to your leader. So when this lady asked Umar, why did you leave the Prophet? Why did you run away? His answer, according to a Sunni historian, Al-Maghazi, Al-Waqidi in Maghazi, Umar said, فَقَالَ عُمَرُ هَذَا هُوَ أَمْرُ اللَّهِ. This is the decree of God. I have no choice over it. God decreed this upon me, that I have to run away. Abu Bakr, of course, the Quran says the reason why they run away. The Quran did not say this is the decree of God or this has been imposed on them by God. Quran says, وَيَوْمَ لَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ فِي مَوَاطِنَ كَثِيرَةٍ وَيَوْمَ حُنَيْنٍ. On that day, the day of Hunayn, إِذْ أَعْجَبَتْكُمْ كَثْرَتُكُمْ. You were maghroor, you became conceited because of your number, because your number was so big. For the very first time in the history of Islam, the number of the soldiers is 15,000 fighters. Usually those who fought with the Prophet were 700, 1,000, 1,500. For the very first time, 15,000 fighters. Abu Bakr, when they were going to the battle, he said, لا نغلب اليوم من كثرة. Nobody can defeat us. After this big number, these big troops, nobody can stand in our face and defeat us. So he was mu'jab. He admired his kathra, their abundance in number. So they said, they did not say God is going to help us. No, they depended on their numbers, not on God. God said, I will teach you a lesson. Since you are proud now of your number, your capacity, your capability, let me see who's going to win. So they were defeated. Within a few minutes, Quraysh ambushed them. It was a valley, it had mountains. Immediately Quraysh ambushed them and they ran away within a few seconds. So this is an opinion of the second caliph. The opinion of the first caliph, Abu Bakr, and this is in Tariq al-Khulafa al-Suyuti. Shaykh al-Suyuti is another Sunni historian from Egypt. He says, a man comes to this first caliph and he asks him, أَرَأَيْتَ الزِّنَا بِقَدَرٍ. When someone fornicates, God imposes that on him, God ordains that on him. He says, in this hour, in this state, on this city, in this location, this man has to commit zina. Is it this from God? So Umar answers him, قَالَ نَعَمْ. Yes, yeah, God decreed this upon you. So he believes that whatever we do is decreed upon us by God and we are stripped of a freedom or choice. We have no choice. God wants you to kill, you have to kill. God wants you to steal, you have to steal. God wants you to drink alcohol, you have to drink alcohol. You have no choice. Not only that, this type of thinking in Jabr, which is still exists today in Saudi Arabia, those of you, the Hujjaj, who go to Hajj and Umrah, if you get engaged in a discussion with the people in the religious establishment, Mutawwa'een there, they tell you, listen, you have no choice over this or that. God has imposed His will upon you, and no matter what you do, you're not going to change it. Yeah, it's not ajib, no. This is what they say, this is what they advocate. And this is a theology that came from the Jewish tradition, not Islamic. The roots of it is in Judaism. Listen to the Quran. The Jews said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, chapter 5, verse 64, وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ يَدُ اللَّهِ مَغْلُولَهِ. The Jews claim that the hand of God, God's hand is tied up. He cannot do anything. What does that mean? It means when he makes a decision, he cannot change it anymore. That's it. It is imposed on him. He cannot change it. وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودِ. This is the belief in Jabr, coercion. That if God says, for instance, this man, Abdullah, he has to live, let's say, for 40 years. that said that man would live for 40 years, even if God decides, because Abdullah was good to his mother, his father, his family, to give him 10 more extension, 20 more years, 30 more years, he cannot do that, because his hands are tied up. وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودِ يَدُ اللَّهِ مَغْلُولَةِ Allah answers them, he says what? غُلَّتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ Their hands shall be shackled and tied up. وَلُعِنُوا They shall be cursed because of the lies that they give against God. وَلُعِنُوا بِمَا قَالُوا بَلْ يَدَاهُ مَبْسُوطَتَانِ Allah has full of freedom. Allah has full of freedom. He can change the ruling, whatever he wants to change. So this idea of jabr, that we have no say and no choice, we are like animals in the jungle. Some of us, God created two types. From day one, when you were in your mother's womb, before you came into this life, he divided us into two sections. Some said, I want those to be super good, and they have to go to paradise. So even if you do bad, you shall go to paradise. And others, God says, those I don't like to see their face. I have to send them to Jahannam. I don't like them. So even if they do good, at the end they have to go to Jahannam. This idea is a non-Islamic, non-Quranic idea. Non-Islamic idea. I read in the beginning, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَظْلِمُ النَّاسَ شَيْئًا This is an abuse. If God wants to impose His will on me and He does not give me choice, and then on the day of judgment He says, you must go to paradise even if you hate me. Or then He tells someone else, you must go to hellfire even if you love me. Then this is not a good God. This is not a good God. This is not justice. This is not justice. Banu Umayyah, they came when they reached power and seized power and control of Islam and the Muslims, they started promoting this idea. Aisha, the wife of the Prophet, she says to Muawiyah, Ya Muawiyah, your son Yazid is very corrupt. Everybody knows about it. Imagine, even Aisha did not want Yazid to be the ruler. So how do you make him the crown prince, Waliyul Ahd after you? How do you do that? It's not good. Listen to what Muawiyah says. Muawiyah says to her, Inna amra Yazid qada'un min al-qada. This, my son Yazid becoming the crown prince, Waliyul Ahd, is the decree of the Lord, divine decree. وَلَيْسَ لِلْعِبَادِ الْخِيَرَةِ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ People have no choice in that. God wants him to be ruler, Amir al-Mu'mineen. You have no say in that. And this is in another historian, Ibn Qutaybah, in his book, Al-Imamatu wa-Siyasa, volume 1, page 167. So they promoted the idea of coercion. Why? Do you know why? Do you know why? Bani Umayyah, they stood with coercion. They said, you have no choice. Why? Political reasons. So when Yazid murders Imam Hussein, you don't blame Yazid. You're going to blame whom? God. When Yazid murders Imam Hussein, you blame God. You say, well, man, Yazid is a good guy. God wanted him to murder Imam Hussein. He had no choice but to listen to God and implement what God wanted him to do. And we're going to continue on this philosophical, deep philosophical subject in the upcoming weeks, inshallah ta'ala. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وأهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين نحمده ونسبحه ونقدسه على آلائه ونعمائه ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأن سيدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارك وترحم وتحنن على محمد وآل محمد كأفضل ما صليت وسلمت وباركت وترحمت وتحننت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. وصل اللهم وسلم على خلفاء نبيك وأوصيائه وأهل بيته وأحبته وأعزته علي أمير المؤمنين وقائد الغر المحجلين، وعلى البضعة الطاهرة فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين، وعلى سبطي نبي الرحمة وسيدي شباب أهل الجنة الإمامين الشهيدين الحسن والحسين عليهما السلام، وعلى علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والخلف الهادي المهدي، عجل الله تعالى فرجه وسهل مخرجه وجعلنا من أنصاره وأعوانه. عباد الله، أوصيكم وأوصي نفسي بتقوى الله ولزوم أمره. في كتاب الكافي الشريف روي عن مولانا الإمام جعفر بن محمد الصادق عليه الصلاة والسلام، One day Imam al-Sadiq was sitting with one of his or a group of his disciples. He said to one of them, he said the following: اقرأ على من ترى أنه يطيعني منهم ويأخذ بقولي السلام. His name was Zayd. He said, Zayd, when you meet with some of my followers who say we follow Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam, we are Ja'faris, we are Shi'as, we are the lovers of Ahlul Bayt, those who listen to me and obey me and respect me, give them my salam and say the following to them. Say the following to them. Listen to the character of the genuine Shia. This is Shi'ism. If you ask who's the Shia, this is the Shia. No more, no less. These are the foundations of Shia Islam. What are the foundations of the Shia? Listen to them. Kitab al-Kafi. He says, tell them, number one, أُوصِيكُمْ بِتَقْوَى اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. Put piety number one in your life. Piety. Righteousness and piety. تَقْوَى اللَّهِ. Nothing above تَقْوَى اللَّهِ. تَقْوَى اللَّهِ is the best relationship with God. The best friendship with God. In this book, if you go through the pages, almost in every page, اتقوا الله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله. اتقوا الله. اتقوا الله. تقوى الله. The best safeguard for us. The best protection. The best type of moral, ethical, social insurance is تقوى الله. So this is number one. والورع في دينكم. In your religion, be careful. When it comes to the affairs of religion, be extra careful. Don't take religion light. Don't practice part of religion and leave the other part. Every bit in religion is important. والورع في دينكم. This is number two. والاجتهاد لله تعالى. Strive not for the sake of dunya or your community or your watan, although they are all important, but make your strive for Allah. If your strive and ijtihad was for Allah, it will be for your watan, for your country. It will be for your community. It will be for your family. It will be for your dunya and it will be for your akhir. Consider Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَالِاجْتِهَادُ لِلَّهِ. This is the third foundation of Shia Islam. The fourth. وَصِدْقُ الْحَدِيثِ. Speak the truth. Say the truth. Don't lie. وَصِدْقُ الْحَدِيثِ وَأَدَاءُ الْأَمَانَةِ. Fulfill the trust. Amana, it could be a position in the government, in a company, in the community, in the family. Fulfill that. Fulfill that to the best of your ability. Don't be lazy at work. Don't be lazy. Don't waste your time at work. If they hire you for 8 hours, work for 8 hours. Not 7 hours and 30 minutes, 8 hours. This is amana. This is a trust. If you have a son, if you have a daughter, take care of them. Take care of your health. Your health is also amana. وَطُولُ السُّجُودِ. طُولُ السُّجُودِ. Prolong your prostration, especially when you do your prayers at home. In jama'ah, I said this many times, the wasiyah, the command of the Prophet ﷺ, when you do jama'ah, do it fast. don't prolong it, because within the jama'ah there are old people, elderly, there are sick people who cannot stand for long. Make it fast. But take your time at home. When you are by yourself, take your time and make your sujood long. وَطُولُ السُّجُود. Because sujood also, the best gesture with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you see sometimes when you love someone, you shake hand, you hug that person? Hugging Allah is to do sujood. It's to put your forehead on dust. تَعَبُّدًا ذِلَّةً. As a humility, gesture of a humility, complete submission. I put my forehead, I don't say no to you, I don't argue with you, I love you, I love you. See, this is the proof of my love, is my sujood. لَوْ يَعْلَمُ الْمُصَلِّي. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, if the one who performs the salat knows how much rahmah and mercy is going to surround him when he does his sujood, لَمَا رَفَعَ رَأْسَهُ مِنَ السُّجُودِ. He would never raise his head from sujood. He would stay sajid, in the state of sujood, prostration. وَحُسْنُ الْجِوَارِ. Be kind to your neighbors. Be a good person in your neighborhood. فَبِهَذَا جَاءَ مُحَمَّدٌ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Imam al-Sadiq says, these are the teachings of my grandfather. أَدُّ الْأَمَانَةَ إِلَى مَنْ اِئْتَمَنَكُمْ عَلَيْهَا بَرًّا أَوْ فَاجِرًا. Give the trust, fulfill the trust to anyone who gave you the trust, whether it was something material or not material. He gave you his secret. He trusted you with his secret. He trusted you with his children. He trusted you with his faith. Fulfill that to him. Whether he's good or bad, barran am fajran, whether he's religious or non-religious. Some people say this company is non-Muslim company, I can steal from this company. I can steal from this country. Imam says whether he's Muslim or non-Muslim, you can't steal from him. You can't betray him. فَإِنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمْ كَانَ يَأْمُرُ بِأَدَاءِ الْخَيْطِ وَالْمَخِيطِ. My grandfather, the Prophet, when they put with him, they leave with him the thread. Thread has no value. And the needle has no value. This is the smallest thing. Still, he will give it back to people if they leave it with him. Even the smallest. Not only the big items. Sometimes with big items, I say this is big. Maybe $100 is nothing. I can waste it. He says, no, even if it is a small, take care of it. Connect with your families. صِلُوا عَشَائِرَكُمْ. And then, how do you deal with the Sunnis? You as a Shia, how do you deal with the Sunnis? Listen to your Imam. وَشْهَدُوا جَنَائِزَهُمْ. Go to their funerals. When they have a funeral, participate in it. وَعُودُوا مَرْضَاهُمْ. Go and visit their sick ones if they are at hospitals or homes. وَأَدُّوا حُقُوقَهُمْ. They have rights upon you. Fulfill that right. فَإِنَّ الرَّجُلَ مِنْكُمْ إِذَا وَرَعَ فِي دِينِهِ. If one of you Shias, you are God-fearing in your religion, وَصَدَقَ الْحَدِيثِ, he speaks the truth, وَأَدَّ الْأَمَانَةِ, he fulfills the trust, وَحَسَّنَ خُلُقَهُ مَعَ النَّاسِ, he's humble, he's not arrogant when he deals with people, he has good manners when he deals with them, قِيلَ هَذَا جَعْفَرِي. Others would say, this is Ja'fari, this is the follower of Imam al-Sadiq. فَيَسُرُّنِي ذَلِكَ وَيَدْخُلُ عَلَيَّ مِنْهُ السُّرُورِ. It makes me happy, makes me proud that one of my followers is a good role model, good example. وَقِيلَ هَذَا أَدَبُ جَعْفَرُ. The Sunnis will say, this is the manners of Ja'far ibn Muhammad al-Sadiq. See, he's truly the grandson of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But if one of you choose to behave differently, in an arrogant way, وَإِذَا كَانَ عَلَىٰ غَيْرِ ذَٰلِكَ دَخَلَ عَلَيَّ بَلَاؤُهُ وَعَارُهُ. His affliction and his shame, his failure is going to come back on me. I am the leader of this madhab. وَقِيلَ هَذَا أَدَبُ جَعْفَرُ. People, the Sunnis will say, see, look at how Ja'far, Ja'far ibn, this is Ja'far ibn Muhammad al-Sadiq. فَوَاللَّهِ, by the Lord, لَحَدَّثَنِي أَبِي. My father told me, Imam Muhammad al-Baqir, he said to me, إِنَّ الرَّجُلَ كَانَ يَكُونُ فِي الْقَبِيلَةِ. A single man, single individual. He lives in a community of Sunnis. But that individual is a Shia. Shia to Ali ibn Abi Talib.
فَيَكُونُ زِينَتَهَا He will be the best among them, the most attracted one ethically and morally among that qabila, that community. أَدَاهُمْ لِلْأَمَانَةِ He is the most honest to fulfill the trust. وَأَقْضَاهُمْ لِلْحُقُوقِ He is the most giving to people's right. وَأَصْدَقُهُمْ لِلْحَدِيثِ He is the most truthful. إِلَيْهِ وَصَايَاهُمْ وَوَدَائِعُهُمْ In that community, when they come, when they have something valuable, gold, jewelry, money, they keep it with that person. They know he does not betray the amana, the trust. He becomes like a safe box. Although they know he's Shia, he's not one of them, but they look at his character. They trust him. They love him. تَسْأَلُ الْعَشِيرَةَ عَنْهُ When you go to his community and ask them about him, they say, مَنْ مِثْلُ فُلَانِ Who could be like this man? He's a jewel of the community. إِنَّهُ لَآدَانَا لِلْأَمَانَةِ وَأَصْدَقُنَا الْحَدِيثِ He is the one who is the most faithful when he fulfills the trust. And he's most faithful when he speaks. This is the ideal Shia. So if we want to follow, أهلاً وسهلاً. This is our Imam. It's our call now. It's left for us. If we want to be Shias that Imam al-Sadiq, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Fatima al-Zahra, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They feel proud of us. This is the way and nothing else. Nothing else. This is the core of Shia Islam. Inshallah, on Thursday the 13th, we are going to commemorate the martyrdom of Lady Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salatu wassalam, because on the 14th is the day of her martyrdom. And I'm going to speak, and also we have a guest speaker, Sister Sachini Strachin, who used to be a Jewish rabbi, and then she became a Christian pastor, and now she's, alhamdulillah, a Muslim, good Muslima, who just went to visit the Atabat in Najaf and Karbala, and she came back just 4 days ago, and she wants to come here and share her experience with you, how she was deeply inspired and touched by Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam, Imam Hussein and Abu al-Fadl Abbas. She's coming on Thursday, inshallah, to speak before me for 20 minutes. And remember, inshallah, next Friday, Salatul Jumu'ah is going to be at 1 p.m. inshallah ta'ala. So try to be before 1 p.m. here. Allahumma aghfir al-mu'mineen wal-mu'minat wal-muslimin wal-muslimat الأحياء منهم والأموات تابع اللهم بيننا وبينهم بالخيرات إنك مجيب الدعوات وعجل اللهم في فرج سيدنا ومولانا صاحب العصر والزمان وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات ثواب الفاتحة مع الصلوات